A supermarket has all the ingredients necessary for overstimulation. The fluorescent lights shine brightly overhead, huge signs point to item locations, and neon stickers boldly mark sales. And while a neurotypical person can often ignore the buzz of fluorescent lights and a sale on ice cream to head straight to the loaf of bread that they came in for, autistic people may have difficulty filtering out many of those other overwhelming sensory inputs. Researchers think hallmarks of autism like sensory overload, repetitive motions, and obsessive behaviors might be rooted in problems with the striatum, an information processing hub in the middle of the brain. The striatum's job is to receive information from other brain regions like the cortex and thalamus, which are involved in motor and sensory processing, then use these cues to drive actions.
The striatum is very important in the sense that it acts as kind of this node of receiving inputs from many brain regions and incorporating many different aspects of information.
Researchers think this cycle of receiving cues, then driving an action, then assessing its outcome makes the striatum in particular crucial for learning.
Many regions of the central nervous system are going to end up being important for autism. The reason to concentrate on the striatum is one of those regions, is because that's a large area of the brain that helps you decide to conduct a certain behavior and then learn to see which behaviors work and which behaviors don't work. And so it's in that way, it's a very central part of learning and decision making and probably learning many of the normal behaviors for which there can be a deficit in autism.
Learning is the ability to flexibly adapt to a changing environment, so striatal dysfunction could help explain some of the inflexible behaviors typical in autism. Rigid habits and obsessive interests may be rooted in the inability to adjust responses according to new environmental cues. Similarly, striatal damage could also cause interruptions to learning that underlie problems with motor control and cause inflexible, repetitive movements. Because the striatum helps us learn to distinguish between important and unimportant sensory information, damage to that system could make it difficult for autistic individuals to prioritize cues, triggering sensory overload.
You begin life with a very, very easy to activate striatum. And as neurotypical people mature, it becomes much, much less active. This is mostly due to changes in intrinsic properties. This may not happen in autism. Plus, it would be a good explanation of why autistic people have trouble often filtering out sensory inputs and feel overwhelmed by sensory inputs.
Striatal dysfunction might also underlie problems with social interaction.
And you can imagine that social impairment is really just a lack of flexibility in response to social cues and an ability to change behavior in different social settings, just like kind of repetitive behaviors in terms of tics or inability to change interests or like focused interests would be.
These problems could partly be explained by genes. Many of the mutated genes implicated in autism are strongly expressed in the striatum, which impairs its structure and function. Some autistic people also show weak connections between their striatum and brain regions involved in reward processing, which might further inhibit learning. All of this is driving researchers to study how the striatum changes during development, and ultimately whether we might one day be able to intervene at specific stages to ease some of autism's traits.